The president. Good morning. The committee stage continues to examine Annex 1D of the Appropriation Bill 2014. We're on the sixth joint debate. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, is he present? Mr. Albert Chan? Thank you, Chairman. Now, on the sixth joint debate, it's about population, youth, education, manpower, arts and culture, and sports. The Home Affairs Bureau, concerning Amendment Number 252, in relation to the Home Affairs Bureau, I have moved an amendment to reduce subhead 53 by $131,731,000, which is equivalent to the annual expected estimated expenditure for the personal emolumentation of staff of HAB. The HAB's has a wide portfolio. Some of the duties are more clearly defined, some are not, and when I talk to local residents, they feel that they have to be very careful when liaising with the district office, because the district offices are like a quasi intelligence unit. The information passed onto the district offices will be put on record, and it is difficult to know what will happen to this information. Now, on the face of it, the district offices are for the purpose of building up partnership with the local communities, and also those deemed to have contribution to society will be appointed to committees. Of course, this is a positive way of presenting it, but now it is an intelligence unit under the communist rule, and also Secretary for Home Affairs, as chairman, you must be very familiar with. Definitely, this organization will have the culture of communism, and the feature of communism is to incite one faction of the community to attack another. So there must be some reasons for appointing this secretary as Secretary for Home Affairs. So we don't know fully the work of the HAB, for example, for the Property or Building Management Ordinance. The Home Affairs Bureau is responsible for enforcing this ordinance, in particular, in assisting residents in forming owners of corporation. And people feel that the HAB is only responsible for delivering the baby but not raising the baby. After setting up the OCs, there are still many problems. For example, the OCs membership, so on and so forth. And sometimes residents may ask the help of district officers to resolve disputes concerning the property management companies. They can't offer any help, and they just ask the residents to approach the duty lawyer service or the free legal advice service at the district offices. This is the Bureau supposedly enforcing the ordinance. Earlier, 2 years ago, I reported I made a report to ICAC about the greedy Zhang, and yesterday there were news that the Department of Justice is considering whether to initiate prosecution. Now, when we make a report to the ICAC, they will tell us a reply, tell us the result of the investigation. Although so far I haven't received any specific reply. However, when we complain to the district office, then according to the, I mean, the HAB is responsible for enforcing the legislation. For example, the OCs are required to disclose their financial position once every 3 or 4 months. And if a member doesn't follow this requirement under the law, then the HAB is the responsible body to enforce the law, and yet they just turn a blind eye. The ordinance provides that the secretary is the responsible official. Of course, there are flaws in the ordinance. For example, in case of non-compliance or non-enforcement, what should be the penalty? You can call this a flaw or a loophole, but at a time when this piece of legislation was enacted, it was considered that penalties would have too much a deterrent effect and people would be deterred from forming OCs. And putting this aside, if organizations do not follow this CAP 344, you have at least to notify them and remind them to comply with the 344. So we have continued to hear complaints from residents based on CAP 344, complaints every week. And especially district councillors would understand very well. They also have to deal with a lot of problems, and there are also other issues, controlling OCs and colluding with contractors in building maintenance. And then through connections with consultants and contractors, they have a very complex relationship. Now, for many housing estates, sometimes a maintenance contract may entail $100 million. And contractors can reap a big profit and can just trickle down some profit to the downstream, to some others. So this bureau has not fulfilled its responsibilities. As a result, building management has become an area very prone to corruption. This problem is very serious. In the 60s, in the 70s, well, as Mr. Leung put it a few days ago, there was corruption, and that's the same. And back in the 60s or 70s, the police would go to a restaurant, put down his hat, and then the money would be put in his head. That's the same for health inspector or FHC inspectors as well. In recent years, the situation has deteriorated because people find CAP 344 close to nothing. This building management ordinance is close to nothing. So this problem is very prevalent. It's really saddening to see that. Of course, there are a lot of requirements under CAP 344, and a few years ago in LegCo, I also set up a subcommittee to review CAP 344. We took 2 years to come up with some recommendations, but the government only accepted one-third, and those recommendations were the consensus among or across political parties. We prepared a report, but the administration only accepted one-third of the report. In the end, we weren't able to amend the ordinance. That is why we have to reduce the budget for HAB to show our dissatisfaction. Apart from district affairs and building management, the HAB is also responsible for sports. In terms of resources and facilities on sports, Hong Kong is the leader. You may it be diving facilities, jogging tracks, indoor games hall. We have abundant facilities of quality. We fare well comparing to other leading countries. However, the prospect of our athletes is really dim. In 2012, I made a submission to the administration on the prospect of sports associations in Hong Kong, and I pointed out some problems with the software, and I'm referring to sports associations in Hong Kong. Now, Chairman, I may as well talk about sports association, or I will be accused of filibustering. I'm talking about 271, Amendment number 271, that is to reduce subhead 53 by $19,859,000, which is equivalent to the annual estimated expenditure for the Hong Kong SCOC. Now, hardware is of course important, so is software. Yesterday, I criticized the Civil Aviation Department for their problems with the aviation monitoring system and their management issues, that it has to do with software. So the same for sports. Even with good facilities, good hardware, in terms of resources utilization, training programs, and selection of talents, if there are problems, definitely, same as building management, sports in Hong Kong will deteriorate. Sports association will be as corrupt as OCs in building management. And years ago, I already urged the administration to handle the issue of venue management properly. And at that time, Division D and Division E associations had an agreement with the then district board, and that some sessions would be reserved for training, and the football associations then sold the sessions, and that was an open secret originally. The fee was 350, and then the slot was resold for 700 or 800, so that the association could pocket the 300 or so difference. So as footballers, we understand very well. That is why some people were very keen to be the person in charge for divisions D and E associations. Sometimes we watch this on TV, and these people just follow the leaders around. One of the reasons they are so committed to football, because to them it's a business, it's how they make money. Look at the football teams overseas. If the teams don't perform well, the leader would be sacked. But not the case in Hong Kong. So the lack of a proper organization for sports associations is a waste of public money, and it is also a serious problem for NSAs, which receive government subsidies, well, I won't repeat them, I've mentioned them before. They never disclose their financial positions, they never publish their financial report. We have no idea where the money has gone, and usually we have no idea about their election. And recently, it was very ridiculous. Some athlete might have got an award in an international event, and then he became a member of another sports association totally unrelated to his original field. Maybe I'll supplement later.
Mr. Gary Fan, Chairman. I would like to speak in this joint debate on education policy and related amendments. I will speak on Amendment 973, cutting head 156, subhead 000, Education Bureau's budgeted expenditure on promoting Putonghua to teach Chinese in education, to teach Chinese in primary and secondary schools. In fact, the scholar assisted in implementing government's language policy. Although the government has not published a policy paper, using Putonghua to teach Chinese has been implemented in disguise. In 2005, the scholar conducted a study, and it was found that there were 208 primary and secondary schools using Putonghua teaching Chinese, 166 intended within 5 years to switch to Putonghua. And then 2008, the scholar issued another program to assist the schools. And from 2008 to 2014, 160 primary and secondary schools joined the scheme. In other words, from 166, half joined the scholar. By now, there are 1,088 primary and secondary schools, among which the number of schools using Putonghua to teach Chinese will reach or have reached 34%. The actual number will even be bigger. Even if the government doesn't publish, doesn't promulgate any policy, many schools have switched to use Putonghua to teach Chinese. But is it really successful or useful? Effective, views are divided. There is no conclusion. The use of Putonghua to teach Chinese started from 2003. The scholar had an action plan to raise the language standard of Hong Kong. But if we look at the report, we found that the arguments or basis for formulating this policy was rather sloppy. They spent about several months to argue for using Putonghua to teach Chinese. But in the study, they said that the sample was very small. Only a small number of Hong Kong schools adopted Putonghua to teach Chinese language. And the studies were conducted by various approaches in assessing the progress of learning Chinese language. And it's difficult to compare the outcomes. The scholar has admitted that there wasn't admitted that there wasn't enough evidence, but it came to the conclusion that using Putonghua to learn Chinese language, there was an increase in improvement in Putonghua capability, and the writing capability were better than those who learned Chinese language through Cantonese. And there is no evidence that there would be a general improvement to language proficiency by learning through Putonghua. But that's rather confusing. The decision was not based on evidence or empirical evidence. They just implemented first and used students as guinea pigs in the scheme. The Education Bureau itself admitted that there was no concrete evidence to prove that the general Chinese proficiency of students learning Chinese language via Putonghua are better. There was no difference between those who learn Chinese language through Zhonghua or through Cantonese. Some who learn Chinese language through Putonghua performed even worse. Now the teachers are used to use a medium which is unfamiliar to teach, and the students learn through an unfamiliar language. This undermines expression and understanding. This undermines the effectiveness of teaching and learning. Even in schools, so-called EMI schools, many teachers still use Cantonese to conduct their lessons, to assist their students to understand. In fact, the mother tongue is the most effective medium of instruction. Now, we provide free education for primary and secondary schools. There is a wide gap among students in terms of language proficiency. And if you use Putonghua to teach the Chinese language, that will only take away their interest in learning Chinese, and this will also damage the passing on of Chinese culture. And we should not put the cart before the horse. Learning Putonghua should not be put above learning Chinese language. Learning Chinese language should not be a should not be sacrificed for learning Putonghua. Now, during the May 4th movement, the educationalists proposed writing what you putting your speaking language into written language, and they proposed to use the vernacular to be put in written language, to be put in writing, so that the so-called vernacular script will represent will be the prevailing writing style. The classic Chinese is difficult to understand. If one just force the use of Putonghua to teach Chinese, that will not help to understand classic Chinese. That is a misunderstanding. If you learn Putonghua and then you are good at Chinese proficiency, you have high Chinese proficiency. If we use our mother tongue, we will be able to communicate ourselves more easily. If you just put them down in writing, sometimes it may sound very clumsy. And there are also substantive words and non-substantial words. And when we put these things down in writing, we will sound like using classic Chinese or very precise writing style. Now, better written capability comes from reading, and more reading and more writing. If you want to link it with the speaking, then link it up with speaking, then you just make it inappropriate. Now, the Cantonese have more tones, and they are easier to understand. A single word phrase is very common in Cantonese, and they're in fact in line with the classic style. Now you can in Putonghua, they usually have phrases in at least two words, but in Cantonese we have many single word phrases, and we are more closer to classical Chinese, because Cantonese inherits the language from the Tang Dynasty. I think a more unreasonable arrangement is that when a school recruits Chinese language teach a Chinese language teacher, one condition is the teacher must be a Putonghua native speaker, and he or she must have experience of teaching in the mainland and has a mainland university degree. Now, those who grew up in the mainland, who learned, who studied in the mainland, they may be good at Putonghua, but they will brought their values to Hong Kong, the text they choose will be similar to the text they choose will be inclined more towards the communist Chinese style. Now, we should not sacrifice the students. The students rely on the teaching of their teachers, they rely on interacting with their teachers. Using Putonghua to teach Chinese will only take away students' opportunity to learn through their mother tongue, and this will undermine their learning opportunities. A Putonghua teacher may be very good at Putonghua, but if this teacher speeds up the speed of speaking, and if the students are not good at Putonghua, they will not understand. And there will be one more barrier to their learning, and they will have less interest in learning Chinese. Mr. Chairman, the 15th of February 2014 is the 40th anniversary of Chinese becoming official language. Now, in 1973, the British Hong Kong government passed law to establish the Chinese as official language. The notices issued, official notices are issued in Cantonese, or broadcasted in Cantonese. Even before the founding of Hong Kong, Cantonese has been the common language of the people. Now, yesterday, the chief executive attended a Q&A. He used Cantonese. And when he read his policy address, he used Cantonese. Mr. Chairman, yesterday, whether you drove members out, you announced stopping filibustering, you use Cantonese. If Cantonese is regarded as having no legal status, then the executive, the judiciary, and the legislature will be put in an absurd language situation. 97% of the people of Hong Kong are speaking Cantonese every day. I agree with Mr. Wong Yongman's amendment to cut the budgeted expenditure by the Education Bureau in promoting Putonghua to teach Chinese. The Education Bureau should respect the history and culture of Hong Kong. Cantonese should be an independent, there should be an independent policy and language policy in Cantonese. Mr. Chen Chi-chuen, correct a pronunciation of your word, Guangdonghua. Mr. Wu Chi-wai, thank you, Chairman. I speak on Amendment 282, cutting subhead 000 from head 53. To cut $3.38 million, which is equivalent to the annual budgeted salary for the Secretary of Home Affairs. As for the SHA, he looks after a wide portfolio from district administration to building management, legal aid, and sports policy, or even the lease for private recreation clubs and policy for public libraries. These are within the portfolio of Mr. Jiang Duck-sing, but we have not seen any thing done by Mr. Zhang to deal with livelihood problems encountered by the people. The most frequent word I heard is comprehensive review. Comprehensive review of building management, comprehensive review of lease for private recreation clubs, comprehensive review for sports policy. I have not seen the SHA taking any responsibility.
He has been in office for more than 8 years, and during that prolonged period of time, well, all these are still under a comprehensive review. It shows that the SHA has not made his best endeavor in leading the Bureau to adopt a new vision. Chairman, I'd also like to point out that in terms of building management, the SHA has not been doing his job. He has not discharged his duty. Well, in terms of building management, I'll be covering that in two parts. First, on the disputes encountered by building management, and recently, we also have problems involving bid rigging for building repair and maintenance, and of course that has to do with the building management ordinance and also the powers that that are given to the district officers, which often are not used. According to my daily contacts with the residents, well, there are often disputes involved in building management, but then for the HAD, it would just rely on mutual aid and organizations established by owners so that they'd be able to improve themselves, and the department would not interfere. And according to the Bureau's instruction to the district officers, well, for all liaison officers, when they are involved in building management disputes, that they should not be giving legal advice, and they will have to be very careful, and where owners seek advice, they should ask them to seek their own legal advice. In fact, in our view, the liaison officers are like labor officers of the labor department. They are not from the legal profession, but then because of their daily work, as they have accumulated experience over the years, that's why when there is anything that has to do with the relevant legislation, they should have the confidence to share their views and interpretation of the relevant legislation with the parties concerned. Of course, where there are disputes and under the law, the liaison officers of the district officers will have to refer those cases to the relevant tribunals, and if it's labor disputes, then of course that will have to be referred to the labor tribunal. And where there are building management issues, they will have to be put before the lands tribunal. So that's the standard mode of operation. So even if you are not a legal expert, but then given the fact that you are more familiar with the legislation in the course of your daily work, you should have the confidence to point out or to give your views. But then it doesn't mean that your views will not be challenged in law. But then the Home Affairs Bureau, why is it giving such an instruction to the frontline liaison officers working for the district officers? The reason, as I pointed out in my first point, the HA Bureau in building management has not been using its powers under the law. Well, still, I think they are only interested in helping with the establishment of owners incorporated. But then once they are established, they would just fold their hands, and they would not be helping them in their operation. In fact, the Ombudsman already said that more than 10 years ago that the Home Affairs Bureau has not been using its powers in helping these OCs, and they would just cite that these are disputes amongst the owners, and therefore they are not prepared to accept complaints and so on. And even if there are complaints, they would still insist on not using the powers, and they would just shirk the responsibility, claiming that this is within the autonomy of the owners, and if that this is not negligent, what is? If you just look at some recent incidents, recently, in a building, there were OC chairmen who resigned. So, he resigned from his post, but then he would keep his status as an ordinary member. In doing so, he would be able to avoid his responsibility or liability as chairman of the OC, because under Cap 344, there are certain restrictions on the chairman of the OC, because he has the duty to convene a plenary session of the OC in order to resolve those disputes. But then we can see that when it comes to such disputes, the Home Affairs Bureau fully understands that there are members of the OC Management Committee who is trying to avoid his responsibilities under Cap 344, and he has chosen to step down in order to avoid taking up the responsibility of convening an owner's meeting in order to resolve the problem. So these are the loopholes under the law, and if there are loopholes under the BMO, then what can the Home Affairs Bureau do? Will it be directly involved and interfering? Will it directly interfere with this? Or it could also refer the case to the Lands Tribunal so that the tribunal will be able to make a ruling. So my question is, well, when building management involves daily management issues, is it that the Home Affairs Bureau is of the view that the loophole can be there for another 6 months or a year, so that the best solution is for the Lands Tribunal to make a ruling? Or should the SHA have exercised his power under Cap 344 by giving instruction that a meeting will have to be convened? And if he is not even willing to do that, then I think obviously SHA is shirking his responsibility as the authority responsible or as a regulator under the BMO. So has the Bureau attached importance to building management problems? Well, in reply to my question, with regard to the liaison officers' establishment is still kept at 120 for individual districts like Yunnan. Actually, we have three liaison officers responsible for over 1,000 OCs. So just imagine, how can they cope with that kind of workload? Well, when I repeatedly ask the same question, the HAB or the HAD will just say that we have invited a large number of outsourced management companies to help these buildings establish their OCs. But then, as we all know, establishing an OC has never been the most difficult part of building management work. The most difficult part is the day-to-day management. That also has to do with interpersonal relationship. It's about whether there is trust, whether or not the individuals are prepared to offer assistance to one another. The OCs, the owners, and also the administration have to have mutual trust before they can resolve these disputes. And yet the Bureau has put the cart before the horse. Instead of increasing the manpower for liaison officers in order to cope with the workload, it just outsourced such work to other management companies in order to help these buildings to establish or set up their own OCs. By adopting this approach, that would only add to the pressure of the liaison officers, because the liaison officers will have to face more OCs. And in the daily work, as soon as they encounter any difficulties, naturally, well, these buildings will approach the liaison officers for help. So my question for the SHA is, by adopting this approach, how can you offer effective support to the frontline liaison officers? And if you do not offer any support to them, then are you being negligent in your work? On the other hand, the liaison officers are not just responsible for building management work. They will also have to deal with district administration. They will also have to deal with community building work. What does that mean? Well, it means that building management is part of their daily work. But then if they want to get promotion, if they want to develop a career, they also have to be able to work in a field of community building and prove themselves to be effective. So the liaison officer's work is not just about building management. They also have to face other tasks in community building, and therefore they cannot just devote all their time and effort to building management. Indeed, half of our population live in private buildings, and if the HA has to be responsible for managing its own housing supply and properties, and if they can have a very large team to deal with that, then comparatively speaking, private buildings have been left to fend for themselves, like orphans, because we only have 100 or so liaison officers and they can only spare some time to help with resolving building management disputes. Is that an appropriate attitude and approach? Well, with an aging, with buildings that are aging, building management will become even more important. And in particular, if you look at the BMO, the safeguards afforded to private owners, the government's role will become even more important. But then last year, when they introduced the professional building management consultancy scheme, I do not see how it can deal with the problems encountered by owners in private building management. Well, they just talk about bid rigging, and they are only looking at the work of the consultants. And in reply to my question, the Bureau also made it clear that the consultancy study would not cover the tendering stage of building repair and management, because that has to do with the consultant and also authorized persons engaged by the building or building management. But then, probably this is precisely the cause of bid rigging, because of the uneven or lopsided information given to the owners, because in many cases involving bid rigging, many of these have to do with external wall repair and so on. And if the administration can help the owners to make an estimate on the cost, then that would be very helpful. But then the Bureau has given the impression that it doesn't want to take up the responsibility, and also for contractors who can pass the threshold of being listed, that's too low, because if you look at the current level, well, it only requires that 10% of the owners will have to attend the owners' meeting, and then so long as there is a majority decision of those present, then that would be binding on the entire housing estate. So just imagine, when we are talking about such an important decision, and if it only requires a small number of owners present at the meeting making that decision, very often that would lead to the OC and also the management company and also the interested bidders. They would try to resort to all sorts of ways and means to ensure that the resolution would be passed by a small number of owners, and they would also try to hide certain information from most of the owners. And very often when the resolution is passed, many of those present might not have any idea about the implications. And in the case of the recent incident involving Choi Wu Fayun, well, most owners might not have been aware that they will have to pay up to $300,000 for the repair and maintenance works. And therefore, the Home Affairs Bureau should have the responsibility to put in more resources and attention on private buildings where half of our population live. And if that's not on the agenda, and if they still try to shirk the responsibility by saying that they are actually undertaking this review, and if they just use the provisions under CAP 344 as a shield for not taking action, then it shows that it doesn't have a heart for this. It doesn't have the intention to deal with these problems encountered by half of our population. These are my remarks, and I support the motion. Mr. Leung Yu Chong. Chairman, I speak on the amendments moved by Raymond Chen and Leung Kwok Hong on head 53. So it's to cut the annual spending estimate for the HAB. I'd like to speak from two angles as to the negligence committed by the HAB, so much so that I'd like to cut their budget, because it has not been doing its job. That's why I don't think we should give them that much funding. And there are two aspects. First, building management. Second, is about their district work. On building management, I agree with the two other members in their criticisms, because as we all know, the Home Affairs Department is responsible for a very large number of buildings. It's not just, well, indeed, other than buildings under the Housing Society, all the other buildings are under the purview of the HAD.
Including private properties, industrial estates, and private housing estates, they are responsible for assisting them to form OCs, for handling building management issues. So they're responsible for liaison work for these housing estates, organization, etc. Just 120 liaison officers to take up all the work is impossible. And some part-time staff has also been recruited for this purpose. However, their experience is limited, the time available is limited. So they, in terms of their service, is not very satisfactory. And very often at OC meetings, it's true that the HAD would deploy part-time staff at those meetings, but their attitude is often like this. They would say that they are instructed to attend meetings but not to speak in the meetings. That means they're only responsible for recording minutes. They are not going to provide any help or give any advice on matters. So we're spending money to ask someone to sit there and write reports for the HAD. What is the purpose? Now, maybe the situation for mutual aid committees is not so serious, but for OCs, the situation is more serious. I mean, they, apart from HAD's liaison officers at OCs meetings, guess who also attended the meetings? The PCRO, the police community relations officer. And sometimes even uniformed police would be on duty outside. And once I also attended an OC meeting, and the OC has asked the police to come to maintain order. So the situation is really bad. The existing manpower simply can't cope. So to do the job properly, instead of cutting spendings, we should increase spendings for them to recruit more manpower. Well, we don't have this power, so I could only support my colleague in proposing to reduce the spending estimate. Now, another problem with CAP 344 is this. We know that this is the most important piece of legislation for building management in private properties. However, there are many loopholes, and also which should be the department responsible for enforcement. I recall that once there was a housing estate and the residents requested the OC to disclose his financial position. And in fact, under CAP 44, it clearly provides that the OC should disclose his financial position annually. So, and the resident first complained to the district office. Well, the district office asked the resident to talk to the chairman. But the point is, the chairman is of the OC was unwilling to do that. And after complaining to the district office, he was advised only to talk to the chairman again. So the OC was still unwilling to disclose the financial position. And then the resident told the district office. According to CAP 344, you have the legal responsibility if this OC refuses to disclose the financial position, you should prosecute that OC. And I also wrote to the HAB, and the HAB still refused to prosecute the OC. That wasn't a good answer, and the matter dragged on for a few years. In the end, the resident himself paid out of his own pocket for a lawsuit against the OC. So it's a matter of dereliction on the part of the HAB. Also, for CAP 344, nobody enforces it. There are also loopholes and flaws. Now, for example, it provides that with the signature of 5% of all owners, the OC should call for a general meeting. But what if the OC still refuses to hold such a meeting? They would not be punished. No consequence. So what can you do? Even if you take this matter to the court can only rule that the OC should call for a meeting. But the legislation doesn't provide clearly the penalty. And the HAB all along has refused to amend the ordinance. It is left as it is. So what is the purpose? It is their responsibility. If they are unwilling to do it, we should cut their spending. This is about building management. This is just a tip of an iceberg. My colleagues have also talked about talk a lot about this area. So I won't repeat them. I will turn to district management. Chairman, since the early 80s, we had the reform, and at the district level, we had DC elections, LC elections, and we are going to have C election. And all elections have to do with district work. That is, if candidates are more committed to district affairs, the easier they will canvass support and canvass votes. Now, if the HAD staff at the district level can be impartial and fair in their work, then that is not a problem. However, since I was elected a district councillor in 1985, to now, I see a very clear picture as far as district affairs is concerned, and that is the Home Affairs Department is not impartial in handling district issues. It is not fair and just and impartial. Instead, it takes a strong political perspective in handling district issues. For example, we have district advisory committees. These committees provide an avenue for cultivating talents. And as we all know, all these the HAD is responsible for appointing members to district advisory committees. And as you can see, 99% of these advisory committee members are supporters of the administration. Otherwise, they won't get appointed. And that's the case for every term. And also on appointment of DC members. Well, very soon this will be phased out, but at present, DC members, some appointed seats are taken by members who are also pro-government. So how can you say that the HAD's work is impartial? Now, Chairman, I have to say this openly, that I don't mind not being appointed. And once a staff of HAD told me that I would be nominated for some kind of medal or an honor. And after making this nomination, this staff member was heavily scolded by his senior for nominating Leung Yuchong. So, Chairman, since 1985, when I was selected as a district councillor, I have been engaging in district affairs. I can say that I am the district councillor staying for the longest term, but I don't mind not having these awards or honors. I won't accept it, even if they present it to me, but the point is political stance matters. If HAD and HAB also has a political stance, and if this in future, during the CE election, the situation will further deteriorate. There will be more social disharmony. And it will be less likely that we have a social harmony or social inclusion. Because if HAB and HAD still has political stance, then the conflict in our society will just continue. Apart from the political bias, very often the HAD staff is engaged in the work that they are really reluctant to take up, that is the district CIA. They collect intelligence. Any anti-government activities in the communities, as long as they hear about it, they will try to get as much information as they can so that they can report to the administration. It's really a nuisance to the community. Through various channels, they try to tap and learn what we are doing, and there is no respect for us. For example, together with a community organization, was going to hold a referendum in the community. Of course, everything is on the table. We don't mind letting them know. But immediately, they ask us what that event was about and so on and so forth. It's a nuisance and it's a waste of taxpayers' money. So I think we shouldn't give them money. I agree, therefore, with members who has proposed to cut the spending. On the contrary, I think the HAB should be responsible for promoting social harmony. And yet, they're destroying relationships, they're making the situation worse. I cannot support the Bureau. Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. Chen Chi-shun. Now, I also have some strong feelings having heard Mr. Leung Yuchong's speech. The HAD should be responsible for promoting social harmony. But now, they are holding activities to stifle opposing voices in the community. Now, we criticize the HAD for being biased and unfair, and even for me with so little experience in politics, I understand very well what HAB is about. Just look at who the Secretary for Home Affairs is. Some say that the HAB is actually an intelligence unit, and some district organizations are pro-government. But I think I'll save this part of the speech until the item for cutting the salary of a secretary. Now back to the point of building management and overseas, I don't have as much experience as other members. But let me turn to my amendment, number 337, that is to cut the annual estimate spending of HAD on building management, that is to cut HAD 63 by $18,625,000. Now, I have this experience. At the OC meeting, sometimes you see bouncer-like muscular men standing there to guard the place. And when you ask whether the HAD staff helped or not, every time we hear stories, we hear that these staff members just sat there and they didn't engage themselves in resolving disputes. Now, yesterday, I started another topic.
Amendments 259 and 260, moved by myself and Mr. Leung, and this is to cut the annual expenditure of the youth square by the looked after by the HAB. In fact, if we cut the expenditure, which is $70 million, or the youth square is operating at a loss. To be exact, the amount is $77.6 million. Originally, it was the target was set at full cost recovery. Now they said they would accept cost recovery by 50%. But I think that is not acceptable. We should cut the expenditure on that. Yesterday, I gave some examples. Today, let me guide you through the youth square. You have not ever, some have never been before. Look at its design, its objectives. See whether it should continue to exist. The objective of U Square is to pull the young people together to organize development activities for young people and be the center of youth activities, provide development opportunity for the developing potential of young people. It is equipped with activities such as multi-purpose rooms, hostels, auditorium and things like that. It is under the HAB, but it's not managed by the HAB. It has been contracted out to New World Facility Management by the operation of the contractor. Young people can realize their potentials and make the youth square the center for youth activities. If you look at this, you know that the youth square is a failure. In fact, it is now living on a drip. Now, just come and make use of the youth square, and we accept, we welcome you. Now, they have a scheme of possibilities. Just come and book and make use of the youth square. You can use it for whatever way you like. There is no principle. The so-called objectives, concepts, they are not necessary. It is said that it is an organic integration. The different activity areas will be grouped together so that activities are integrated so as to enhance young people's incentive to go around. You've spoken on that. What is the core of the youth square? What is the core of the youth square? It is the Y Center. It has 643 seats. Just like the Queen Elizabeth Stadium, this is a performance hall. And they have also the why they have the Y hall. I in fact once rented this. Perhaps at that time they regarded me as a youth. This is the Y Theater. Let us look at the usage rate of this Y Theater. I have never been there before, but the usage rate is not high, I believe. The usage rate in June is less than two-thirds. It is really empty. Nobody is using it in June. Look at the timetable. Let me read it out. It doesn't have any activities. It's just a few. Second of June in the afternoon. This is a church activity. It's not related to youth policy. In order to cook the books, in two evenings, they show two old films. They show two old films and Indian films. The Three Idiots. And also the user is the youth square, and you really don't know whether they're distributing tickets free of charge. And then in three evenings, dancing, Italian, two evening Italian music, and then two evenings a choir. And that's all. Its usage rate is less than a community hall. Probably it is a hall of higher standard. You need to fill in more forms. You need to pay a higher rental charge. But the usage rate is very low. If it is to promote youth policy and then be a center for youth development, a focus for youth development, it's really of no use in these regards. Why is there the youth square? Why did they spend $800 million on a building whose future was not sure and the usage rate was not sure? Now, that was, in fact, for maintaining stability. At that time, it was the peak of activities of those who were born in the 1980s. You can look at it from this perspective. The more the money put on uniform groups, youth policy, that was in proportionately high in terms of youth expenditure or youth policy. This year is the same because of the government's fear towards Occupy Central. They put more money into uniform groups. Say, on the 4th of June, they have the film of Three Idiots. People will not go there. They want to attract young people to go there to attend the healthy activities. Then you will not join the activities organized by the LSD or scholarism and other groups. The youth square, according to the administration, is to provide healthy activities, pro-establishment groups to conduct activities so as to reduce the number of young people joining the anti-establishment. But the pro-establishment groups don't use the youth square. So youth square is not just a white elephant. It's worse than a white elephant. This youth square should be the focus for youth development activities. That's ironic. It has become a studios, art studios, piano shops, and also the piano practicing rooms and the like, or tuition rooms. So they try to change it, let people do some small business. Say if you want to run a tuition school, you can't rent a place, so you rent a place from the youth square. So the tuition schools, the music studios, the art studios, go there. But they are small business. They just fill up the space. As at the end of last month, when DHAB provided the data on the letting out rate, there was a sudden improvement from an empty hall. They now turn it into half full. The management company drove away the organizations which were not so closely related to the theme. With the increase in the usage rate, and they want to get some brand names. But at the start, it was a wrong decision. The concept for having this youth square was unclear. The policy was unclear. Initially, it was meant to be self-financing. It was meant to serve young people. They are conflicting. And they focus youth development in one building in Chi-wan. I find it remote. I don't find it remote, but some people find it very remote. When I organize a show, I give out some tickets free of charge. They didn't come because they said it was remote. It's not just by two MTR stations. Now, Sunbeam Theater is just two stations away from Youth Square. Well, but the young people don't go to Cantonese operas. Well, perhaps if the Cantonese opera troops are going to rent that youth square, to hire that youth square, they will let it out to them. Now, whether it's hardware, it's software, they're not good. You allow young people to apply for subsidy to rent the venues from the private sector, from NGOs, that will be much better than putting money into the youth square, put it on a drip. The youth square is now operating not in line with its policy objectives, and the usage rate for the purpose of developing young people is very low. It's a waste of public money. More than that, the department has problem in maintaining this policy and maintaining this. Now, if you ask Zheng Daxing to come out and then kill this project, nobody has the courage to do that. Mr. Zheng cannot do that, then let the LegCo do it. We cut the expenditure, you have to think of it again. You have to think through the matter before you come to ask us for money. If I'm going to have a youth square to make money to help the tuition schools, then I would do it somewhere else. I'd do it in Tin Shui Wai in Sheng Shui rather than at the youth square. Thank you. Does any member wish to speak? Mr. Albert Chan. Thank you, Chairman. Yes, just a while ago I spoke on sports. Afterwards, members speak on building management. I'll make a short supplement to that. In 1988, the HAD introduced a consultation paper and proposed to legislate to regulate building management companies to rectify problems in building management. One solution is to turn building management into a profession. The building management companies are responsible for day-to-day management of buildings. They have a very important responsibility. The relationship between contractor and building management companies, relation between owners corporation and building management companies, and building management companies colluding with outsiders to make money illegally is a common phenomenon. How can you make sure that the building management companies do not blatantly make use of its power and possession to seek illegal profits. You rely on the investigation by the ICAC, but the transfer of interest is rather obscured and secret and secretive, and it's difficult to investigate.
That's why back in the 1980s, they talk about a two-tier licensing system, including some property management company staff, like managers and also professionals. They will have to be professionally licensed. And then for the other agents, the companies, they would also have to be licensed. So it's like estate agents. So there would be companies license as well as individuals license. So through this two-tier system, if there is any complaint against the individual's negligence, then through the regulatory body, you can file a complaint. And then, for example, if the property management company failed to act in accordance with CAP 344 in preparing its financial report, then you can also file a complaint. And also, the owners can also request to inspect the financial report or have access to financial information of the management company. That's very important, because if you're able to check the receipts and invoices, well, in the past when I assisted some residents in gaining access to those documents, we found out that many of these are property management companies are subsidiaries of developers, and then at the start of occupation by those estates, if some of the estates have not been properly managed, and yet they are actually trying to charge the owners or the residents management fees in order to put up certain notices and signs or signage. So without checking those receipts, you will not be able to tell whether or not the actual expenditure was reasonable. In recent years, well, some housing estates use the residential units water supply to clean the commercial or the shopping center's premises. So the shopping centers should have been the responsibility of the landlord. And therefore, if you do not check the receipts, you will not be able to find out the truth and the facts. But then at present, if you want to check those receipts, the management companies or the OCs can refuse, and there is no way that you can take the matter forward. So even if you file a complaint with the district office, well, nothing can be done about it, and the only thing that you can do is to submit an application to the Lands Tribunal, and only after the Lands Tribunal has issued an order can action be taken. So if you complain or file a complaint with the district office will just ignore you. So back in 1988, at the time, the administration suggested that there should be a two-tier licensing system so that professional property management would be subject to regulation. With that law in place, and if the property management company does not keep the receipts for inspection, then I can file a complaint saying that you have been professionally negligent or you have committed professional misconduct. But then after the consultation in 1988, many owners and quite a large number of smaller property management companies were in favor. But then, because some of the major developers under reader were strongly against it, that's why it was swept under the carpet for more than 20 years. And there was another round of consultation, but then apparently it's going to be born a still born. It's going to be aborted again. So the law has been under discussion for many years, and yet apparently is going to be aborted after all. So whenever there are interests in relation to the big conglomerates and also the major developers, the obstacles that you might come across is simply unbelievable. All right, 10, 20 years ago, when we talk about the sale of incompleted flats, well, it was only after the perseverance of the very tough bureau director that we managed to get it through. So thanks to the tough bureau director back then, we were able to pass this. And if you just rely on a BMO and also Chang Tak Sing, I'm not optimistic at all. probably recently, because they are trying to maintain stability and everything else would be subordinate to this. That's why everything else will be sidelined, and therefore the interests of the public would be set aside. And therefore, when we talk about this, we should focus on forcing the administration to come up with a legislation so that we can have a two-tier licensing system, so that some of these property management problems can be improved. Only then will we have some hope of resolving this problem. And therefore, Cap 344 should also be amended. All right, these are the points that I've already made. I'm not going to repeat them here. Next, I'll turn to some issues relating to sports. As I said, the HAB is also responsible for sports policy and also monitoring the NSAs. And many of these have to do with our sports policy. For example, Amendment 271 is to cut the is to slash its funding by some $19 million of the ASFOC. But then, it's nothing to the Fox family. But then, through this, I'd like to point out the messy accounts of the ASF and OC, because if the structure and the operation are messy, then the entire our sports performance will definitely be poor. Well, if you look at the ASF and OC's situation, well, every year they are given more than $18 million. And this year is up to $19.85 million. And according to the guidelines and also the documents of the organization, well, it's responsible for the following areas, implementing the drug ban scheme and also the regulatory regime, and also for retired athletes, they would offer assistance and development opportunity. And also, through the promotion of sports, we'd like to encourage the public to adopt a sport. And the SFNOC supposedly would have to submit this on a quarterly basis to the HAB on the details of its spending and also the breakdown. And it would also get reimbursement on an accountable basis. And SFNOC must provide audited annual report on government funding. So it's only required to submit this report to the administration, and there is no requirement for it to release it to the public, and the public also do not have the power to inspect their records. So it's still a collusion between the government and the business sector. So it's collusion between the government and the small circle cronies. And you can see that for athletes and the ordinary public, they have no chance of coming into contact with those in power and rich. And also, in coming up with the appropriate funding for the SFNOC, I think, well, as a body responsible for monitoring the use of public money, this council should have the right to have access to check whether or not the subsidy or subvention and funding have been put to good use. Well, some members are against me quoting the audit report. I think the audit commission will have to play a bigger role here. All right. As you can see from the budget, we have to give them $19+ million, but then where has the money gone, and whether it has been used in the correct way, whether or not it has to enhance the level of transparency, and whether or not the annual report will have to be disclosed. Do we have the power to inspect those records? All right, some members simply couldn't care less. If this is not collusion and connivance, what is it? So when you point an accusing finger at those who are rich and powerful for colluding with one another, there are grounds for this. Well, many people are against it because you have some dirty linen that you don't want to display to others. Well, in fact, in this council, if you have any doubts about the spending by members, well, even if you just purchase a pen, you will have to have the receipt. But then we are giving them $19 million, and yet we have no idea as to where the money has gone. And of course, I do believe that Timothy Falk would not personally be interested in pocketing the money. But then there are many NSAs and people who try to make a living out of these, and their livelihood has to do with currying favor with the rich and powerful. And therefore, if you check the details of these financial records, then you're actually breaking their rice bowl. So for athletes' livelihood, nobody can be bothered. Well, earlier on, we also have the League A athletes. Some of them have attempted suicides. Actually, others managed to kill themselves. All right. For those shoe shiners, they continue to make a lot of money. And yet for the others and the athletes, they have spent their prime years and dedicated their prime years, and they try their best to do proud to Hong Kong, and they've managed to have a lot of accomplishments, and yet these accomplished athletes ended up committing suicide. This is really very sad, and that has to do with the structure of the organization, and if nothing is done about it, it will only continue to rot. And many people call the Sports Commission and the SFNOC a black box, and if you look at the organization itself, it's also very rotten. So I call upon these organizations to do something about it, because the law cannot take them to task, well, unless we do not provide them with funding. But then in terms of their actual operation, and if you look at the provisions of the law, well, the administration should have imposed certain conditions. Of course, we agree that the administration should not interfere with the independent operation of the SFNOC. Maintaining independence is very important, and if you are able to operate on your own, and if you're able to convince other international organizations to recognize your status, then of course it's about your own ability and competence. But then, since you're using public money, you're actually representing Hong Kong when you go out, then there is a responsibility on your part to be accountable to the public. All right, you're using public money, and yet you do not have to be accountable for that. For example, when you attend international meetings or conferences and so on, you're representing Hong Kong by hoisting Hong Kong's flags, but then you claim to be representing Hong Kong. All right, you sound very authoritative. And also, you are self-inflating yourself, and you feel good about yourself. But then when you come back, if athletes manage to win prizes and awards, all right, you will stand by their side to take group pictures. But then after the halo is gone, nobody would be bothered about the athletes and what happened to them. As to their hardship and plight, nobody would offer a word of comfort to them. Well, earlier on, I also talked about the rich and the powerful and how they trample on the dignity of the athletes and how ugly they look. Well, this is something that I'd like to take the opportunity to criticize and to condemn. Hong Kong athletes is not there for you to insult, and their dignity should be respected. Does any other member wish to speak? Gary Fan, Chairman, I pressed the button to request to speak. Chairman, in this joint debate, I'm speaking for the second time, and I'm speaking in support of Mr. Lam Kwok Hong's amendment number 933, cutting head 156, subhead 00. It's about the Education Bureau's annual spending on training teachers, and according to Mr. Lam Kwok Hong, the reason why he's proposing this because he'd like to have more resources for training teachers. But then in scrutinizing the budget, well, members are not allowed to put in amendments to increase the estimates or budget. That's why Mr. Lam Kwok Hong is proposing this amendment, so that we can at least have a discussion on this. So I'm of course in favor of increasing resources for training our teachers in Hong Kong, because if you look at the total amount of resources on teacher training, that's most inadequate. Earlier on, together with the subcommittee on education, we went to Kowloon Bay. We visited a primary school promoting integrated education. So some of the students with hearing impairment were integrated with normal students. And in the end, we felt that in terms of teacher training, the resources given by the administration had not been adequate.
And now, my following speech will focus on Chinese language teaching for the ethnic minorities group in Hong Kong. All along, this has been criticized. Although in the policy address, it's been said that there will be a framework for teaching non-ethnic minorities Chinese as a second language, but this only covers primary school but not secondary schools, so there'll be a bridging problem. In fact, for ethnic minorities, usually they only reach junior secondary proficiency in terms of a Chinese language, because they cannot read or write Chinese. And for ethnic minority students, even if he has a first class honors from institutions, he still finds it difficult to get job interviews. Now, in the supplementary guidelines to the curriculum published by the Education Bureau, there is nothing for support for ethnic minorities. As for the adjustment programs, they are usually for learning phonetics. Also, for major textbook publishers, they find publishing textbooks for non-ethnic Chinese in learning Chinese very difficult. Their clients may only be some international school students. So in the end, the responsibility is shifted towards school teachers. At present, only Hong Kong U and the Polytechnic University of Hong Kong have courses for training teachers teaching non-ethnic Chinese language, and there is a high turnover rate because of the high level of difficulty. The EOC commissioned between 2010 and 2011 a survey covering 5,136 individuals who were teachers, school principals, parents, and also another study covering 475 respondents on the equal opportunities for disabled students and students under inclusive education or integrated education. The study found that only 26% of school principals of these special schools underwent special training. 49% of the teachers never received any training on integrated education. The result was astounding to many. Chairman, as a teacher, one must not only rely on the curriculum and the textbooks, one should also make adjustments to the program teaching strategy and curriculum based on the competency of students. Therefore, teachers should design their programs according to the needs of students to help them learn. So, an efficient teaching or effective teaching requires careful planning and design. However, with a packed curriculum, teachers of Hong Kong find it impossible to devote so much time and energy to deal with the teaching strategies I mentioned. Also, for special students with special educational needs, different types of SEN students have different requires different tactics. So teachers require or a need to undergo training, and they need the support from the government and the education bureau so that they can help SEN students and NEC students, so that they don't need to spend too much time and energy on unsuccessful attempts, because these unsuccessful attempts can be good reference for education bureau, and the ethnic minority students can also have a level playing field in education. Now, the UN Convention protects ethnic minority children in having the same opportunities and learning opportunities. However, the UN Children's Committee has criticized Hong Kong for also comments that this we have a discriminatory system. However, the government responds by saying that it is the parents' choice to allow ethnic minority students to be accepted in non-Chinese speaking schools. This is the result of the choice of parents instead of the government's policy. So this is very mean and irresponsible. The government ignores the learning difficulties of ethnic minority children. The government did not provide pre-primary Chinese learning for ethnic Chinese ethnic minority students. This is for this reason that without any choice, parents find no alternative but to send their children to designated schools for ethnic minority students. So this is putting the cart before the horse. And non-Chinese speaking students are also subject to the same kind of Chinese language examination. So that non-ethnic Chinese or non-Chinese students, non-Chinese speaking students only account for less than 1% of the total number of students enrolled in Chinese language-related courses under Drupas. So under this system, we can see that there is no level playing field for non-Chinese speaking students to pursue tertiary education. All these issues are intertwined, and in the end, NCS students are exploited of the chance of pursuing tertiary education. So I support Mr. Leung Kwok Hong's amendment to cut the spending on teacher training, and there should be more training for teachers teaching ethnic minority students so that they can also have the same starting point as other students, so that our next generation can be protected regardless of their family background, their ethnicity. Everyone can have the same learning opportunities and learning environment. I so submit, Chairman. Mr. Chan Kim Po. Chairman, I'd like to speak on Amendment number 337 in Joint Debate number 6. This is Mr. Chen Chi-chun's amendment that is to cut Head 63 by $16,645,000, equivalent to the annual estimated spending for personal emoluments for HAD staff. Now, before we support cutting and spending, we must understand how they perform. Throughout the years, the HAD has encouraged owners to set up OCs, in particular for single block buildings. OCs should be set up to assist owners in managing their buildings. Over 10,000 OCs have been set up throughout the years. And on two occasions, in the estate where I live, there were calls for OCs to be set up. In the end, the residents voted down the proposal. And I witnessed the whole process. And I understand there are loopholes. The administration is conducting a review. However, in the interim report, it pointed out that in terms of the guideline for appointing OC, a proxy to OC meetings, there are loopholes. Now, I have personal experience in this matter. And just now, as mentioned by colleagues, after setting up the OCs, very often there are even more problems. Very often, there are major loopholes to appointing proxies. And because for larger housing estates, many residents would appoint proxies to vote on their behalf, and this will definitely affect the result of the voting result. For example, the convener has the greatest power, and then there is no monitoring. And at present, only 5% vote is needed for calling for a meeting. There are a number of loopholes. For example, there is no vetting mechanism for the convener's proxy. There is nobody to verify the authenticity of the convener's proxy. However, it is also unreasonable that others can check the proxies of residents opposing to the meeting, and there is no criminal liability if the proxy is not genuine. And on the selection of venue, the issuance of forms, voting process, etc., all are arranged by the convener. And obviously, there is a conflict of interest. The convener is at the same time the umpire and the player. It is unreasonable, and the government should not ignore these problems. On the collection of proxies, it's again a big loophole. 48 hours before the meeting is held, the proxies should be submitted to the convener. However, there are also controversies. If proxies are only dropped into the mailbox of the convener, how can you ensure that these forms are received by the convener 48 hours before the meeting? And if these are not considered as properly received, residents would have to go personally to for the vote. And if the residents don't go, it will be very or can't go, it will be very unfair. We have made some proposals to amend the BMO, which should plug the loophole. And for the guidelines issued, it has set out the details to help owners understand the ordinance. However, in reality, there is no legal consequence, even if the guidelines are not followed. So the guidelines are toothless, and there is no deterrence effects on those not complying, and those who rely on the guidelines might find themselves disappointed and deceived. So on proxies, I suggest that the arrangement be changed, as proxy affects voting results, and the voting process should be fair and impartial. Those with conflicts of interest should not be in a position to determine whether to collect proxies and to determine whether they are valid or not. So a third party should be engaged, such as the HAD, for collecting proxies and verifying the proxies. For example, the collection box should be placed with the district office, and the district office should decide whether the proxies are valid or not. They should be the decision-making body. Now, the HAD has a manpower shortage problem. However, the HAD can charge major housing estates for the service, and there will soon be a public consultation. I think the government should plug the relevant legal loopholes and the loopholes in the guidelines.
The loopholes in respect of proxy arrangement have to be dealt with. There are more than 10,000 buildings which will get into trouble, and then it will not be conducive to forming new OCs to deal with the problem. Building management is directly related to people's livelihood. The present system has many loopholes. I've only mentioned the process of setting up OCs. There are already many loopholes. Just now, members have spoken on the problems after OCs have been formed. There are many, many problems. And if a policy can affect the livelihood of people living in more than 10,000 buildings, the HAB should conduct a review on itself seriously. This is a problem which has been there for such a long time. If it cannot be resolved, it's really acceptable. The HAB has been encouraging housing estates to set up OCs. When it comes to the present stage, it has already achieved something. Over 10,000 buildings have their OCs. The next step is to improve the present arrangement so that the management of existing OCs can be regulated by law. They have to comply with the law. They cannot be given free rein in order to give citizens a fair deal. The Home Affairs Bureau should invest heavily into doing this job. It should resolve serious problems related to building management. The proposal to cut expenditure of the HAB is really going against this objective. We have no power to increase its budget, but if the performance is poor, you dismiss all the people, then it goes against making any improvement. They should put in more resources, and they should deal with the consultation on BMO very carefully. And if they do not deal with the issue of proxy arrangement, I will vote against the bill. I hope the ICAC will attach importance to this problem. A lot of corruption cases are caused by the inadequacies in the BMO. I hope the ICAC will assist the Home Affairs Bureau and try to solve the problem so that the system can be fair and impartial and the law can be improved. The ICAC also has an important responsibility. Mr. Leung Yu Chong. Mr. Chairman, I will speak on Mr. Leung Kok Hong's amendment. Number 958, head 156, cutting $3.38 million, which is the budgeted annual expenditure of the Secretary for Education. I will speak on several areas in respect of the popular opinion of the Secretary, his visits, the change in policy, and the change in population's policy, and the students, SEN students, in particular, they care for deaf students. First, on the popularity rating of the Secretary. The popularity rating of the Secretary is one of the lowest among the policy secretaries, according to the opinion poll of the Hong Kong U in terms of those who support him. It's about support or dismiss. When he was appointed to the post, it was the highest. At that time, the supporting rate 32.6%. That was the supporting rate. Since this quarter, the rates declined to 19, 18. That is the rate of supporting him. Recently, the highest supporting rate was 25.2 in September 2013. People supported him to remain in his post. But as for those who asked to dismiss him, the highest is 57.5%. More than half of the people interviewed asked for dismissing him. And this rate is hovering around 48, 49, so around 50% of the people against him. You can see how he fared among public opinion. With such a low popularity rating, how can he remain in his seat? If he is a minister in another country, he has already stepped down. But in Hong Kong, because of the flaw in our system, however bad our minister performs, he can stay in his seat safely. He just treats public opinion lightly. And he can continue to remain in his high place. He has such a low popularity rating. Why should we pay him such a fat salary? The second issue is on his overseas visits. I think second to the CE, this Secretary for Education has the highest number of overseas visits. He has at least conducted 13 overseas visits. Recently, he went to Finland. He claimed that he tried to learn from the successful experience of Finland. We cannot question that. We cannot question whether it's useful or not. But in a period of nearly 2 years, we have not seen him introducing successful experience from overseas into Hong Kong. What we have seen is that our the performance of the Bureau is getting worse and worse. He spent how much? He spent $2.6 million on his visits, and he has not made any contribution to reforming our education system. There was none. And people keep complaining. Parents keep complaining against our education system. People keep complaining against the inadequacies of the system, and they have voted with their feet. They send the children overseas to study instead of staying in Hong Kong. And also, we see parents sending their children to international schools instead of going to local schools. If we don't face up to the problem, we are worried about the future of we are worried about our future generations. The next issue is the change in the population of students. We've heard cutting schools, killing the schools. Schools are closed down, and the teachers are worried. They are concerned about their job security. That's the problem of the secondary schools, though the administration has decided not to close down schools, but because of cutting the number of classes, teachers are sacked. In the school from which I have resigned, that school, the school has also sacked a few other teachers. Teachers face the problem of job security. They are very concerned about the future. And that's not good for our education, or not good for the education of our children. In this year, there is a rapid increase in the demand for kindergarten places. In many districts, there aren't enough places in the kindergartens, not just in the North District or Tuen Mun or Yuen Long. Even in Sam Shui Po or in Kwai Chung, there aren't enough kindergarten places. Several parents came to me and asked for help. They said that they were unable to find a place for their small children. They asked from help from the education department, but they were just given a few numbers. And then the parents called up those kindergartens, and then they were told that their children would only be on the waiting list, and they are only on the waiting list. And the school year is coming, and how can they deal with this? There aren't enough places in gardens, there aren't enough places in primary schools as well. We have been fighting for small class education. Chairman, you are one of us in this regard. Um, 25 students per class is a suitable number, but this year, the primary schools are forced to expand the class size to 30. Now, they closed down primary schools. Now, they ask the primary schools to expand their class size. They say there aren't enough classrooms. Well, just a few years ago, they closed down primary schools. We asked them not to do so. They didn't listen to us. They closed down the primary schools, and now we don't have enough primary schools, and therefore they increase the class size. Education policy is in a mess. We can't just blame the government of the previous term. Edding should take the blame. He should have foreseen this problem, and he just couldn't care less. He just conducts overseas visits time and again. Is he up to the mark? Is it the right attitude? Good policies are not continued. Small class teaching is a good policy, and yet we expand class size and we go against it. It's Secretary for Education just like doing overseas visits. Is he asking parents to send their children to study overseas? Let me now turn to the ASEAN students. They are students of special education needs. If the statistics are right, they account for 25% of the number of students in Hong Kong. That's a high percentage. These ASEANs have special needs, but their needs are different. Some are hyperactive, some are autistic. They need professionals to help them. But the Education Bureau has no solution to work for these, to care for these ASEANs. There is no policy to increase the number of professionals to help the ASEANs. They just couldn't care less. In overseas countries, a quarter of the children who committed criminal offenses are students with difficulties of learning, and if they've gone astray, then their whole life will be affected. This is very important. Why can't we put more resources into helping these SENs? We've made a number of proposals. We propose that in each area there should be some centers to support the schools so that the ASEAN students can go there after school and they can be provided with professional help in order to enhance their quality of learning. But the government just turned a blind eye to that. They don't listen to us. The problem is dragged on, Chairman. 1 year delay will cause greater problems to more students. I really hope that the Secretary can become down to earth and do something concrete for our education system and for our children and solve the problems in our education system.
Apart from the SEN, there's another problem that's been dragging on for years. And actually, we've talked to the Secretary about this for a year or two, but it's not been resolved. It's about the artificial eardrum. It's important for those with hearing loss, the ear implant, actually. If ear implant could be placed when these people are young, it's important for them. The hospital authority is responsible for doing the implant. But of course, these are devices, they may break down, and when they break down, who will do the repair? But then hospital authority colleagues said that it's a matter of education. But then the education bureau said it's nothing to do with education, it's about medical device, so it's an issue for the hospital authority. So the two parties passing the buck to each other for more than a decade, they're still passing the buck to and fro. And what's happening now for these students? Of course, many parents couldn't afford to pay for it. And the education bureau says it's not our problem. Hospital authority says it's not our problem. So the students are caught in between. Actually, we know that this ear implant would help students to learn. So how come it has nothing to do with the education bureau? How come they just pass the buck to the hospital authority? And of course, the hospital authority may also share some responsibility, but why can't they too share the cost? But both of them just wouldn't budge an inch. So there's been no movement on this front, and there's been discussion for more than a decade. The Secretary for Education knows about this, he just doesn't do anything about it. And at the end, it's these students who suffer. Now, the Secretary spends a lot of the time going overseas, he spends a lot of money, but on the quality of education, that's not improving. Actually, it's regression. So why are we paying so much to this Secretary? Why wouldn't the Secretary try to spend more time to find out about issues on education? Once, we went to Mui Wa to meet with a group of parents about their school. The South Lantau Island School has been left vacant for years. Parents don't want their children to have to get up so early in the morning to take the ferry to Central and come home very late. They hope there will be a school in Mui Wa, so they want their school to be converted, but the Secretary wouldn't listen to them. Mr. Wu Chi-wai. I'm speaking for the second time in this debate. I just want to point out that the Secretary for Home Affairs has not